Months ago, we uncrated Ford's new turbocharged EcoBoost to power our F-100 project. Today, the men fire it up. Plus, simple how-to on refreshing your interior. That's all today on Truck Tech.
Doesn't matter if you're a Chevy guy or a Ford guy, in today's show, we've got something for you. We've rolled Project Nitrane back into the shop, and we're going to fix up the interior just a little bit. Now, under the hood where our Duramax sits, we're going to add an intake, intercooler, and see if we can finish up some of the plumbing.
And we've also started back on our 55 F100 project. Now, I've been working hard, and I've got the cab back into primer, along with getting the bed ready as well. But for today, I need a break from doing body work.
Totally agree. Now, let's see if we can't check out this 3.5-liter EcoBoost that's between the frame rails of the 55.
Pretty awesome setup.
Man, I'm totally glad we were able to get our hands on one of these.
Ford was the first major automaker to leverage the idea of a smaller turbocharged engine powering a half-ton pickup. And let me tell you, they hit a home run.
365 horsepower and 420 pound-feet of torque. And great fuel economy thanks in part to direct injection and all-aluminum construction. Now, we were excited to find out that we could get this engine directly from Ford Performance as a complete package, and it comes with everything you need, including the computer, wiring harness, and all the other modules to get you running.
Now, depending on what application you have, whether it's a classic truck like we have here, a street rod, or you even want to use one for towing, this computer will accept a wide range of tunes to suit whatever you're after.
Now, I don't know about you guys, but we haven't heard this thing run, and we are dying to see what this EcoBoost will sound like. So what do you say, Jeremy? Let's get it fired up.
I can't wait to hear it run. Let's get the bed off and run some fuel lines.
All right. One, two, three. In order to fuel the fire of this EcoBoost, we gotta lay out the fuel lines where they will go so we can cut them to length and assemble them before we wire up the engine harness.
How's that?
It's perfect.
Now, I've ran a ton of fuel lines over the years, but just mainly steel or aluminum hardline. Now, I know a lot of people like this Earl's Flex braided hose, so I figured I'd give it a shot, see what I think about it. For one thing, these lines are super easy to work with and they save a ton of time. You don't have to worry about cutting or bending any tubing or taking the chance of getting any kinks. Yeah, it's a little more expensive, but trust me, when you're building a rig like we are, it is well worth it.
We're going to be mounting our fuel pressure regulator from Holley on the frame rail somewhere in this vicinity. Now, we're not exactly sure where it needs to go because there could be some other stuff that needs to occupy this space. But we're going to get it temporarily installed so we can get the fuel up to the engine. We're going to take the same approach with our fuel lines. Even though they're cut to the exact length they're going to be, we're not going to permanently mount them until we have the frame assembled after paint. Let's get this bad boy wired up.
This is the first EcoBoost we've had the chance to put in a project, but not the first we've had our hands on. Last season, we pulled some big power out of a new F-150 with only a cold air intake, a 93-octane tune, and a good flowing exhaust. We gained an additional 69 horsepower to the rear wheel.
That's 366 horses out of a tiny 213 cubic inches with twin turbos, making this 3.5 from Ford Performance a stout choice for anybody wanting big power in a small package. Just like many aftermarket engine control harnesses, what we got from Ford Performance is mostly plug and play, but there are a couple wires that you will have to terminate on your own. First of all, we've got the fuel pump wire that goes to the hot side of the fuel pump. Pretty straightforward. We've got an ignition switched wire. This one's pretty important. This one has to receive voltage when the key is in the run position, but also when it's in the crank position. I know a lot of older key systems don't work that way. We've got the start request wire, which that one's pretty simple. It just receives voltage when the key is in the cranking position. We've got a battery wire, which receives voltage pretty much all the time. And lastly, we've got a ground. Now, once we make all these connections, we can test for fuel leaks and maybe this thing will start right up for us.
Run our fuel pump wires.
Yeah, got a power and a ground right here for you.
The last thing we have to do is put a jumper on the clutch pedal travel switch. This way the computer will think that the clutch pedal's pushed to the floor and let the engine start. We've done all of our final checks. We've got oil in the engine, we've got fuel pressure with no fuel leaks, and everything's hooked up electrically. So what do you say, Jeremy, you want to fire this thing up?
Let's give it a shot.
All right. Sounds good.
That's awesome. Now, if any of you guys at home have a new engine laying around and you're anything like we are, I know you really want to hear that thing run. But remember, when you do this and you don't have a cooling system hooked up, only let it run for about 10 seconds or so you don't damage anything. But now that you've heard it run and you know there's no problems, you can go ahead with the rest of your project.
That's right. And the next time you guys see this project, we're going to be finally assembling the entire body the last time before it gets blown apart for paint.
Man, I'm glad to hear it run. That's awesome.
That MagnaPulse sounds real good. I love it. This thing will be a good runner.
Coming up, great ideas to refresh your truck's interior.
Before Jeremy gets started on the interior of Project Night Train, I'm going to be up front finishing up some of the plumbing. You'll remember that Project Night Train is our 87 Chevy 1500 that we're swapping in an LBZ 6.6 liter Duramax engine and Allison 1000 automatic transmission. Last time you guys saw the engine, we had just barely got it started. At that point, the wiring harness was just kind of thrown on top of the engine. Nothing was permanent. Since then, I've taken the time to organize the wires, kind of route everything in nice, safe places, and get all the components mounted like the computer and the transmission control module. The next biggest problem that we found out was the stock intake. The Y-bridge and intake pipe was just way too tall. There was no way it was going to clear the stock hood. I pulled a page from the old school Hot Rodder's handbook and took a little bit of modeling clay and stuck it on top of the alternator. Once I shut the hood on top and compress it, I'll measure and this will give me the maximum height the intake can be. I'll probably leave about a half an inch clearance for the intake below this level. After doing a little bit of research, I found Pusher Intakes and they were willing to manufacture us some custom intake parts that'll fit below the stock hood. Using the measurements I provided them, they gave us a version of their Supermax Y-bridge, their HD charge pipe, and the newest offering, their turbo inlet. Now, for you guys at home who have a late model Duramax powered Silverado, you can get the same kind of technology from them that offers up to a 92% increase in flow. While you can choose from up to 9 different colors of powder coat or a natural finish, we ordered the titanium gray.
Now the interior in this truck was trashed. You can see through the years of people climbing in and out over this old seat fabric how it's taken its toll. There's just not much left there, along with the foam losing its shape, and it's just gotten flat. Now our dash is in the same shape that our seat was, which is pretty common for this style truck. They dry rot over the years, they start to bust, and they get really lumpy. Now you could send this thing out and have somebody recover it for you, but that gets pretty expensive. You could also attempt it yourself because you have this metal base to start with. But lucky for us, LMC Truck makes restoration parts for a lot of different classic trucks, including our 73 through 87 1500 pickup. Whether it's GM, Ford, or Dodge, LMC Truck has been the go-to source for hard-to-find or obsolete parts for the past 35 years. Headquartered just outside Kansas City, LMC customers are able to call, go online or visit their showroom and choose from over 30,000 parts in their inventory. And today, that inventory keeps growing. LMC Truck maintains a serious collection of early and late model trucks and SUVs, which doubles as a test bed for thousands of parts they manufacture themselves. One nice thing I like is LMC's catalogs are more like shop manuals, with detailed photography and schematic diagrams to help guide you through the restoration process. And since our interior is basically bare, we ordered a molded plastic cover to take care of the dash, new carpet, and new foam and vinyl for the bench seat. Since we're not going to be reusing this cover for any reason, we'll go ahead and just cut it off. Now, once you've got your foam removed, this is a great time to go ahead and inspect your seat frame for any damage or anything like that. Now, as you can see, someone's already replaced a couple of springs here. Now, normally what I would do is go ahead and clean everything up and get a fresh coat of paint on it. But since there's no rust anywhere and it's so nice, there's no need to do that. But our seat back, it's injected molded from the factory, and no one's making replacement foam for the 81 through 87 pickup. So, looks like we're pretty much stuck with it. Go ahead and get this thing covered. it's not a bad idea to go ahead and pull a measurement on your frame and find your center point. And once you make that mark, do the same on your foam and your seat cover as well. This way, if you start working with it and it gets off at all, you can refer back to your marks.
Yep, look pretty good.
Back at the front of Project Night Train, these are all the parts that we're gonna need to finish up the cooling system on our Duramax. We're gonna start by installing the intercooler that we picked up from Summit Racing. I got out the welder and I built these custom mounts that the lower part of the intercooler will bolt to. I also had to trim a little bit of sheet metal, and also to accommodate the 4-inch core of the intercooler, I had to cut and reinforce the edges of the core support. Now this will all let the intercooler sit behind the grill. To make the connections at the intercooler, I just used some leftover 3-inch stainless mandrel bend exhaust tubing and welded them up to make the right shape. And on the aluminum tube on the engine side, all I had to do was cut the end and just give it a little bit of a twist. Due to the unique cooling requirements and odd hose size of our Duramax diesel engine, an off-the-shelf radiator just wasn't going to cut it. I sent an email over to Performance Rod and Custom Radiator in Boonville, Indiana, and they sent me this beautiful hand-fabricated aluminum radiator. It has oversized -10 transmission cooler fittings and a large 2-inch lower outlet that matches up with the Duramax radiator hose. When we combine it with the dual 16-inch spall electric cooling fans they provided, there's no way this radiator is going to have any problems keeping that engine cool. Best part is, it installs right into the factory location. I knew that the stock lower Duramax radiator hose just wasn't gonna fit. It was way too long, had a bunch of funny fittings on it, and a special O-ring connector at the end. Rather than going to the parts store and fishing through a back room of radiator hoses trying to find one that might or might not work, I'm just gonna build my own from 1¾-inch stainless steel. Had to weld in a nipple for the coolant reservoir. I got everything finished welded and gave it a nice coat of satin clear.
Next, how to get your shifter off the column and onto the floor. Stay tuned.
We're back on Truck Tech for our last full day buttoning up Project Night Train by finishing the cooling system and refreshing the 1500's interior. With the seat fully covered,
looks really good.
Jeremy can move on to addressing this worn out dash.
Even though we're gonna install a new dash cover on here, we wanna go ahead and knock down some of these high spots. That way we ensure that our new cover stays good and flat. This isn't as bad as it looks, and it's not beyond repair. The reason we chose to go ahead and put a new dash cover on it is because it's a very inexpensive way to make it look really good. Now, I know what you guys are thinking. Why in the world am I painting a dash that I'm gonna cover up? But the answer's simple. This dash was blue, and I don't want any of that sneaking in on us.
The last two things we need to fabricate for Project Night Train are mounts for our shifter and accelerator pedal. We can't use the column shift on this truck because the Allison transmission is just so large, there was no room to run the linkage. So I picked up this floor shift from Summit Racing. It's made for a car, so I'm just going to come up with some way to space it up off the floor just a little bit. After that, I'll take care of mounting the accelerator pedal. Based on the height of our seat, our shifter needed to be 4.5 inches off the floor. It also needed to be mounted firmly, but allow the carpet to pass underneath without having to cut giant holes in our new rug. I decided on a mitered bridge style base. I used some thin wall square tubing and cut the center section to the same length as the base of the shifter. Then I'll mark and drill 4 holes. I'll cut each end at an angle, then weld in some 1/4-inch nuts to make the shifter removable. The legs are cut to length, also at an angle. Then I can TIG weld the whole thing together for a nice, clean, industrial look.
It looks really good. Makes it look like a brand new one. Now, a good way to do this is to go ahead and mount the dash in the truck. This way we know we get the cover exactly where we want it to be. All right, slide this thing in here. There's just a few clips towards the front of the dash that slide through slots in the framing. A few screws secure it. Silicone adhesive is dabbed on the original to hold the new LMC dash cover in place. We'll use sandbags to hold it down until it hardens.
To mount our shifter pedestal in the cab, this 1x1 angle iron will attach to the floor of the truck, leaving about 3/8 of an inch for the carpet to go over. Our bench seat goes in temporarily to determine the front to back position to mount the shifter. And with it out, I can weld the tabs to the floor permanently. The very last bit of fabrication is going to be a mount for the throttle pedal. Now, because of the contour of the firewall and the offset in the throttle pedal, there's no flat real estate that I can just bolt it straight to. So I'm going to start by tracing the outline of this throttle pedal onto the steel, and then when I drill the holes, I'm going to weld a nut straight to the backside of it. I'm then going to mount the plate to the firewall on the edge that will actually make contact. Then I'll have a little bit of a brace to make to fill in the gap on the right-hand side where the firewall contours in. Once everything is tacked into place, I can double-check the positioning. Then I can burn it in for good.
Now I've got the inside of the cab all masked off, and we're done with all the modifications we're going to do to our floor. So we're going to spray on a couple of coats of this Sound Control by Lizard Skin to try to keep out as much noise and vibration as possible from that big diesel engine we swapped in. We've also got this Super Pro application kit. It comes with a gun, the mill thickness gauge, and the mixer. But what's really cool is they send you this 90 degree head so you can spray on those really hard to get to areas. Lizard Skin recommends that you don't spray their Sound Control over bare metal, so I've primed a few spots that needed attention. This material takes 75 minutes to dry, 24 hours to fully cure.
We'll finish up the cooling system with some extended life antifreeze from AutoZone.
Then our carpet from LMC Truck can go in. Followed by our custom shifter pedestal.
All right, let's get this bad boy in.
Then the bench seat can go in for the final time, followed by the accelerator pedal.
One of the challenges of installing this newer electronically controlled engine into an older vehicle like this Chevy is instrumentation. All the gauges in our dashboard are mechanical, and the Duramax engine has no place to mount their sending units. A great example would be the speedometer. It's mechanically driven by a cable, yet the Allison transmission has no cable drive built into it. A good thing to keep in mind, though, is all vehicles manufactured after 1996 have all the information that your gauges would normally display recorded by the computer and sent to the OBD2 port underneath the dashboard. A great way to display all that information is with this Edge Insight CTS2 multi-gauge monitor. It's plug and play straight into the OBD2 port and can be configured to display a variety of readings like boost pressure, water temperature, RPM, even gear position, and of course, the vehicle's speed. The 5-inch full-color high-resolution touchscreen is easy to read at a glance. It's even light-sensitive, so it will automatically dim at night and won't blind you. Our truck's computer is already tuned for bigger power. For you diesel guys out there wanting a boost in performance, though, you should check out Edge's Evolution CTS2. It has all the same great monitoring features as the Insight, but will also give your truck a boost of up to 180 horsepower over stock. They have applications for all the major brands, plus they're compatible with external accessories like a backup camera or a pyrometer.
Whether you make a living in the automotive industry or you just want a nice, secure place to store your tools, Matco Tools has hutches, carts, and boxes in every shape, size, and color. Our hutch is 2.5 inches taller than previous models, with convenience power right up front. And so your power tools don't walk away overnight, this integral power drawer keeps chargers and batteries plugged in, so they'll be charged up and ready to go in the morning behind this locked cabinet. And to keep jobs right here in the USA, their toolboxes are made in their Jamestown, New York plant. You gotta love that.
Today we've made some great progress on Project Night Train. This thing's pretty much ready to hit the road. We just gotta finish up a few details. What do you think?
Yeah, we'll get the grill, the hood back on it, and maybe even do a spray-in bedliner. Man, what do you say we take this thing to the drag strip?
You know what? I bet if we get this thing to hook up, it'll probably run some pretty decent times.
Yeah, I think it'll be awesome. But I'm not riding with you. I've seen you drive.
What are you talking about?